Good morning.
Good morning.
You may have noticed that things are a little different this morning. This morning's worship service is meant to be an opportunity to reflect on, remember September 11th, 10 years ago, and to hopefully move forward in hope with the light of God. Our opening reading will be interspersed with a Taze hymn, which is found in your pew box or your pew hymnals on page 296. We invite you to sing along when you feel comfortable when the choir sings.
Inside of us, and even the emptiness where meaning should be in our lives.
the loss of so many lives, of safety, of innocence, and the things we couldn't even name had left nothingness in its wake. All the things which had seemed so big and so important and had taken so much space in our lives were suddenly smaller, and in their place, we found the emptiness.
They may hear your voice above all others and act in such a way that brings about
without healing and reconciliation. O God of mercy. For those who mourn and wonder, O God, where were you? May they know your presence and see how you used something that was meant for evil to bring about something that can be used for good. O God of mercy. For our enemies, the ones for whom we would rather not pray, and for ourselves, lead us from prejudice to truth. Deliver us from hatred and revenge. Give us courage to overcome our fears and build bridges, that we may stand before you reconciled through Christ our Lord. O God of mercy,
hear our prayers.
We remember with affection those who now rest from their labors. Keep us in fellowship with all your saints, and bring us at last to the joy of your heavenly kingdom. O God of mercy,
hear our prayers.
Hear our prayer, O Lord. Increase in us the gift of faith, that our lives may reflect your glory, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now if you'll take your pew Bibles and turn to page 862, we will read together in unison from Psalm 23.
Rubble is a nice green plant. It's sort of the idea that God, even in bad things, even when things fall down all around us, like buildings, God still gives us hope. God is with us even. Is anybody ever had a spanking? Well, I did too. And even when we feel our very worst, God is with us. Even in tragedy, God is with us. God is with us all the time. Would you pray with me today? Dear God, we thank you that you are always with us. Help us to realize that while we're not thinking about it. Help us to realize that even in our saddest times, even in our joyful times, all the time, you are with us. In Jesus' name, thank you.
Thank you.
asking that you bless them, that they may go forth into this dark world and shine the light of your hope, of your love, and of your kingdom in all the dark places. Lord, we offer you the best that we have, and we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Some folks came and said to Jesus, "Did you hear about those whose blood Pilate mixed together with the offering? What do you think they have done that they would be punished so?" Jesus responded, "Don't think it's like that. Don't think that it's like because something bad happened to them, they deserved it. They had done something to bring it upon themselves. Do you remember when the tower at Siloam fell? Do you remember that moment? And all the people who died in it? Do you think that they had done something to deserve that? Do you think that they brought that upon themselves? That they brought the tower down upon themselves? No." And today, as we remember 10 years ago, towers falling down, we pray for those who are lost. We pray for their souls. We pray for their loved ones. We pray for those who deserve more, who deserve longer, whose lives were cut short well before they deserved to. We pray for those who went in, who went into the falling towers, who went into the flames, not asking what might happen to them, but asking, "What can I do for someone else?" We pray for all of those who have been lost since then. We pray for all of those who have been taken by violence, especially due to that day. All of those whose lives were also cut short, even though they had done nothing, even though they were just trying to live their lives. We pray for them as well. Let's go to God. Lord, as we gather in this place, we ask that you help us. Help us to remember. Help us to know that you are with us. Help us to remember your light in the midst of darkness. Help us to remember that even in the moments when we think all is lost, you are there. You are with us. You are lifting us up and guiding us. Lord, help us remember those who have lost lives in the midst of senseless violence, uncalled for violence. Help us to remember all of those who were bearers of your image, whose light was snuffed out. Help us to remember that their light is your light, and that we can continue to carry on that light. We can continue to bear it ourselves. And we can choose to either be bearers of light or bearers that take away light. God, help us to remember. Help us to respond. Help us to reach out in the ways that you would have us reach out. We can all remember. Bring light, to bring healing, to fix the broken places through your power and through your grace. It is in your Son's name that we pray all of this. Amen. I remember 10 years ago, I was a senior in college. I know that may seem unfathomable for many of you. But I was a senior in college. I had not yet ever preached a sermon. I knew my calling was into ministry, but I had not done anything other than study to become a minister. It was hard to remember how I was 10 years ago, but I can remember. I can remember where I was, what was happening. I can remember my phone ringing in my apartment. Tammy was on the other line saying, just turn on your TV, we'll talk a little while. I can remember turning on the TV, seeing images that I didn't even understand. It took me 5-10 minutes to even know what was on the screen. There were words running across the bottom, and there were flames, and there was smoke. It took me 5 minutes just to understand it. It was so far beyond my imagination that something like this could happen. I'd heard from my grandparents about the bombing of Pearl Harbor. I had heard from my parents about the day JFK was assassinated. I had heard about days where you remember every moment. I had lived through the Challenger explosion, but that wasn't quite the same. I remember being 22 years old, looking at a TV screen, and not knowing what in the world was happening. And I remember the emotions bubbling up, and each of us felt in our own way myriad emotions as we looked at that screen, as we watched those horrific and terrible images. I remember wondering, where do I go? What do I do? How do I live? What now? The world had fallen apart. I knew I had class at 1 o'clock. So I sat and I watched TV for a couple hours until it was time to go into class. I had not heard anything from my professor as to whether or not class would go on, so I went on in. And on the way into my building, I ran into a professor that I respected and I admired a great deal for the 3 years that I had known him. And I had always thought that he seemed to know what was going on. So I was happy to see him, thinking maybe he can provide just a glimmer of something to hold on to. As I walked up to him, I quickly realized he had nothing. He, as far as I knew, had never smoked, but he reeked, as though he had smoked an entire pack of cigarettes all at the same time. I thought, he doesn't even know. We arrived in my philosophy class where we were supposed to be talking about critical thinking, and my professor of critical thinking looked out at us as a class and said, I don't know what to say. I don't know what to think in this moment, and so it's probably best if we just go on back to wherever we were. If you want to hang around and seek some consolation in each other, please feel free to do so, but I don't know what to say and I don't know what to do. I can remember those hours and those couple of days not knowing. Not having any idea. I can remember showing up for class a couple days later. We had a combined class with two professors that I had run into that day. The professor who had reeked of cigarette smoke now seeming to have a slight bit more together, and the professor of critical thinking still not really having it together. And they said, we just want to combine our classes and let you all open up, speak about what you're feeling, what you're thinking, what's going on. And I can remember some of my fellow students students, some of my classmates, wanting to grasp a hold of something that they could say, they could think, they could do something that could bring some form of meaning. And I can remember an argument breaking out. There were those who said, it's time, let's go bomb them back into the Stone Age. By that point, we figured out them meant somewhere in Afghanistan, even though many of us didn't know where Afghanistan was. And they said, let's go bomb them back into the Stone Age. Let's get our retribution. Others responded, from what I understand about Afghanistan, they're in the Stone Age already. We can't do this. We can't seek this kind of violence that has already been enacted on us. And an argument, a fight broke out. And I can remember the first moment of clarity I had in the midst of that arguing, in the midst of that fighting about how to respond, how to grasp hold of something. I can remember being struck by the idea that we weren't going to do anything. We could sit and talk about our ideas in that classroom for what we should and what we shouldn't do, but that wasn't our decision. What we should and shouldn't do was up to the president and to the military and to Congress. That was not our decision. What we could do was to reach out, to offer help. I don't know whether God provided me with that moment of clarity or just a lifetime as a Christian. Either way, I think I got there through God. But I spoke up and I said, give blood. Send water to the people who are helping with the cleanup effect. Do something. All of this stuff we're arguing about, we can't touch it. It's not ours. There is something we can do. There is something we can grasp a hold of. Reach out. Help those who are hurting. If you know someone who lost someone, call them on the phone. Go to them. Offer them a hug. Offer them your presence. Do something. Reach out. Bring hope. Bring light. Bring life as best you can in this moment. As the weeks go by, I knew things would change. There would be opportunities to do other things. I remember very clearly 2 weeks after the attacks, my brother calling me up, already having worked his way pretty well up into Lockheed Martin, saying, I'm thinking about enlisting. I don't know, but I feel like it's the right thing to do. I can remember that conversation. I can remember others, friends. I can remember those who had family members who were enlisting, who were reaching out, who were trying to do something. And so on this day, 10 years later, the call remains. Reach out. Bring light. Bring life. Bring love and healing. Offer whatever you have. Give the best that you have for God's kingdom. We are reminded, looking at this pile of rubble, we are reminded by those images that are burned into our memories. The world is a broken place. The world is a place where there is pain, where there is hurt, where there is oftentimes nothing but darkness. But new life does grow forth. New hope does spring forth. Through God, through our work together as members of the kingdom of God, new hope comes. New life comes. For the next 5 minutes, I'm going to ask that we spend time in prayer, in meditation. You received a small green sheet of paper on your way in this morning. If you're inclined to do so, write down your prayer on it. Bring it forward and place it in the cross, knowing that we have somewhere to turn with all of our prayers, all of our needs, all of our hopes, and all of our fears. If you feel inclined to do so, being reminded that it is God's light that drives out the darkness. Come forward and spread the light. Come forward and light one of the candles, one of the tea candles, using one of the taper candles. I invite you to spend the next 5 minutes in prayer and meditation. Feel free to come forward when you're ready. Finally, today, as we prepare to gather around this table, we are reminded Paul's words that nothing can separate us from the love of God. Not life or death or powers or principalities, nothing. Nothing can separate us from the light and the love of God. We're reminded that it is because Jesus' sacrifice, because of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, that we can always come. We can always come to God. We can receive His love and His light and carry it forth. So as we prepare for our time of communion, let's sing number 387, Bread of the World and Mercy for Everyone. Take and eat the bread of life.
Eternal God, our Father, we thank you for the gift of your Son, as once again we return to this table, set in memory of our Savior, Jesus. We return here again and again to renew our spirits. We return here again and again for the peace and love we find here. We return here again and again to find Christ in these quiet moments of personal contemplation. Bless this cup, Father, emblem of his sacrificial blood, and Father, bless us as we receive it.
Take and drink the cup of salvation. Thank you. For as often as we eat of the bread and drink of the cup, we proclaim Christ's death and resurrection until he comes again.
Thank you.